This is episode number 192. Today, we're featuring the amazing Josh Clare.
This is the Plein Air Podcast with Eric Rhoads, publisher and founder of Plein Air Magazine. In the Plein Air Podcast, we cover the world of outdoor painting, called plein air. The French coined the term, which means open air or outdoors. The French pronounce it plein air. Others say plein air. No matter how you say it, there is a huge movement of artists around the world who are going outdoors to paint. And this show is about that movement. Now, here's your host, author, publisher, and painter, Eric Rhoads.
Thank you, Jim Kipping, and welcome to the Plein Air Podcast. I am Eric Rhoads, and as we speak, I am at Fall Color Week in New Hampshire. We're there to paint the incredible leaves. I'm pre-recording this, of course, and so I'm not actually there now, but I'll be there by the time you listen to this. And it's a retreat where we paint the fall leaves, and we're going to have a great time. Hope you'll join us sometime for Fall Color Week in the fall or in the spring in the Adirondacks Publishers Invitational. It's just a retreat where we paint, so that's pretty cool. I want to mention to you, just as a reminder, right around the corner is Realism Live. It is our virtual realism conference. It's the first time we've ever done a conference, first time anybody's ever done a conference that includes things like portrait, figure, still life, landscape, plein air, flowers, and many, many other subject matters. And we've got some of the world's leading experts, including the great Odd Nerdrum, and of course, Mark D'Alessio and Eric Capel and many other landscape painters. And you will not want to miss this. Remember that as a plein air painter, we're informed by the things we learn and grow. You want to learn still life. You want to learn figure and portrait. These things will make you better at all things. All right. So another thing you want to do is go to realismlive.com and get signed up. At least check it out. And there's a beginner's day on the 20th of October. And even if you do nothing else and you want to learn the beginning basics of those topics, go to the beginner's day at realismlive.com. Also want to mention to you guys that the Plein Air Convention is going to take place, and it is going to take place in Denver this year. Before COVID, it was record numbers. We were almost sold out, and now word's getting out that we're probably going to be able to go. Everything's going to be fine. We have 100% money-back guarantee in the event that we do have to cancel or you have to cancel, but please know we're going forward to the Plein Air Convention, and the super early bird deadline price expires on Black Friday. So get in there, get it now. There's still plenty of seats, but if we have to socially distance, then we're almost sold out already. If we don't have to, then we'll be able to add more seats. So check that out. Also want to mention to you that we've got an event called Watercolor Live coming up in January, and you can learn more about the greats there at watercolorlive.com. So the three things to remember, realismlive.com, pleinairconvention.com, and watercolorlive.com. Also in this podcast with Josh Clare, I mentioned Russia, and I'm taking a group of people to Russia. And so you'll want to learn about that. It's at paintrussia.com. All right. In the next issue of Plein Air magazine, we've got an article called Out of India. It's about painting in India prior to COVID and sketching and paintings from the trip. It's going to be pretty cool. You want to see that. Also, in the Plein Air Today newsletter this week, we're going to be talking about some of the salon winners. We recently gave away the Plein Air Salon Competition winner for the year, which was really a wonderful event. And if you haven't seen that online yet, you go to pleinairsalon.com and you can see that. After the interview, I'm going to be answering art marketing questions in the Art Marketing Minute. But first, let's get to this incredible painter, Josh Clare. Josh Clare, welcome to the Plein Air Podcast.
Hey, thank you.
I'm really looking forward to this because I'm a real big fan of your work. I guess you could almost say a groupie.
Well, thank you. That's super nice of you to say.
Yeah. So, Josh, why don't you, for the benefit of people who are listening around the world in 30, 40 different countries, some people might not know exactly what you do. How would you describe yourself?
That's a really great question. I would describe myself as a guy who's learning to paint. Really.
And how
really
would you would you describe your paintings?
Impressionistic and realistic. Impressionist realism. Something along those lines.
Okay. All right. Terrific. Well, how did this all begin for you, Josh? When did this painting journey start?
So I feel like my journey was a bit unique, right? I drew, you know, all growing up, and I loved, it was kind of, I think my art addiction started with Disney movies, actually. So Glenn Keane, if you've heard of him, the animator, the legendary animator Glenn Keane, who was kind of a key animator on Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Pocahontas, Little Mermaid. Those were, you know, I was 8 or 9 or 10 years old when those were coming out, and just thought, man, if I could draw like that someday, then I'd be happy. And just spent my time doodling. But I didn't take it super seriously. It was just something that I loved. And so it wasn't until college that I took a painting course and started to kind of think more. Well, I got married, and then I thought, man, what am I going to do for a living? And started looking more deeply into the art world. I knew that I needed something for my spirit. I needed something creative. I loved it so much, and I wanted it so bad. So I tried graphic design, tried illustration. I liked them both. You know, it's fun to create. But having a boss was very hard on me, having someone else call the shots. So
I'm the same way. I can't be managed.
It was, yeah. And thank goodness for internships, because I really enjoyed graphic design. But the moment a guy that I thought had very poor taste, you always think that, right? If the guy over you makes decisions that, anyway, but he wasn't an art guy. He was a business guy, and he was calling shots on creative things, creative decisions that I was making. And I just thought, this is horrible. I can't do this. So that internship was a huge blessing, and it turned me around, and it started me looking for, you know, what was going to work for me in the art world. And so about a junior in college, and never been to a gallery, never been to an art museum. And we took, it was my first painting class, Oil 101.
And what college and was this?
We were up at BYU, Idaho.
Oh, okay. Well, I know BYU in Provo has a fabulous art program. They have a good program up in Idaho as well.
Fantastic. It was dreamy, actually. It was so good. One of the best realist programs in the nation, and I just kind of stumbled into it. It was so good. Yeah, so that first class, we were about an hour from Jackson Hole, Wyoming, and we drove in and went to the Wildlife Museum and the galleries. And very naively, I saw prices on paintings, and I thought, oh, heck, holy cow, this is fantastic. I'll do this. I'll just make paintings.
It looks so easy.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, I loved, it was so fun to see them. There was Bill Anton and me on C2, and just some killer pieces in Trailside and Legacy. And I thought, man, this is it. I want to do this, and I'll be the boss, you know? And so that's when I found fine art halfway through college. And then I was lucky enough to have just a fantastic education, first of all, and then to have professional artists close, like Scott Christensen lived 30 minutes away, and he came over and did a, you know, a lecture, and he had a show in the gallery there. He kind of shared with us just how difficult, like he told us that he felt like he started learning to paint and learning to see after 2,000 paintings is what he said, 2,000 paintings from life. And so I knew I had that in my mind right from the outset, that this is going to be, I've got to paint from life, and I've got to work really hard. So that's what I started doing, and worked really hard for a couple of years till I graduated, got into a gallery just months after I graduated. And that's that's how we started.
Wow. And the rest, they say, is history.
Yeah, kind of. You know, I mean, I got into gallery, started selling work, but I was teaching part-time there at the university. And so that was really the miracle. That's what carried us. You know, I was able to support my family with that part-time teaching job, and then gallery sales just were bonus for a while. And once the gallery sales got to a point where we could do it, we went, okay, let's try this.
That's a really encouraging story. I would think for a lot of people listening to know that, I know it's not easy and it didn't happen overnight, but to know that it can happen like that is very encouraging.
Yeah.
What is the best advice that you would give to your former self, the young college age guy who decided that he wanted to become an artist? Looking back at your art training, looking back at the beginnings of your art career, what would you change or do differently, if anything, or what's the advice that you would give yourself now?
So the advice that really made it for me, I think, that changed everything and that made it work was Bill Anton, actually. An email to Bill Anton. And I sent him some of the work and just said, you know, I love so much what you do. And I actually asked him, hey, can I apprentice with you or anything like that? Could I, you know, come study with you? And he said, no, you don't want to study with me. and he said, get out and paint. He said his single bit of advice was take your act outside. And he said, within, you know, a couple of years, if you get outside and paint from life, you'll be painting circles around your peers. So there were those two. I had Scott Christensen tell me 2,000 paintings from life and Bill say, get out and paint from life. And so I got out and painted from life.
Yeah. Sometimes it's just as simple as following somebody's advice, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. And that really was like, I look back and I look at my paintings over those years and the big growth happened when I was painting, really consistently, but more than that, I would say diligently, like really focused painting from life, really purposeful and intense painting.
Well, I think that makes a huge amount of difference, and we've had that, you know, that similar story so many times now, and that seems to be the one thing that really pulls it all together is just getting out, and of course that's why. This is the Plein Air podcast, not the landscape podcast.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. No, and it's, yeah, so that's it. That's the thing. Get out and paint from life, and that's when the real growth, I think, happens.
Yeah. It's fun to watch people go through that, too, because you can watch somebody. I remember when Richard Lindenberg left his full-time job, and he was, you know, painting on the nights and weekends. And when he did that, the first thing he did is he went up and he apprenticed with Scott for a week, helped him out. And then then he just painted all day, every day. And to watch the growth happen in 2 years, the growth spurt was phenomenal just because, he was following that protocol. And I think that's your advice is the best possible protocol anybody could offer.
It's key. That's really key.
Well, now that you've answered all the questions, I guess we're done.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
There it is.
Yeah. So in terms of, you know, people like to understand some ideas or thoughts on paintings. You know, your paintings have a certain je ne sais quoi about them. There's an essence to your paintings that have a spirit in them. They seem to be rich with story. And there's something that you're doing that's creating that. Are you simply going out and reflecting what you see from life, or are you really putting a lot of time and thought and effort into developing these paintings before you paint them? What are you doing?
So, yeah, I found that for myself, and this is something that I think is important to say to this audience, to the Plein Air audience, that my time outdoors is best spent just really studying, learning. And that happens the most when I'm not trying to create a finished piece, but something that just taking notes. So very careful color and value notes is what I try to do when I'm outside. And if I can do that on a small scale, like a really small scale even, I find that it's more truthful. It's more accurate. Because as we all know from painting outdoors, things happen so quickly. And so I think I've quoted Soraya for years as saying, if you're painting more than 5 or 10 minutes outside, you're lying. But I haven't actually found the quote, so I'll have to find that for sure. But yeah, just really small sketches from life is what I do a lot of. And I bring those back in the studio and, take a look at, I'll do those from photos as well, actually. And I've painted enough from life that, like Matt Smith does this really well, where he can take a photo that's just really bad, like a really bad color, kind of a gross little photo, but he knows what it should look like. He's been outside so much that he can make it look right from a poor photo. So I'll do those little sketches from photos that I've taken in the field as well. And those are what guide me. Like when one works, and I can see that kind of clip. When you look at 30 sketches on the floor or whatever, you can pick out your favorite ones. It's not hard. And those are the ones that I'll take further, go bigger, and refine the design and kind of start the studio work to make paintings after that.
Yeah. Now, talk to me about your process. Are you, when you go out and you, whether you're doing thumbnail sketches, whether you're doing other things, whether you're doing a finished, or not, maybe not a finished piece, but a full painting versus a quick study, are you,
yeah,
do you do thumbnail sketches first? Do you, help us understand, yeah, your process when you're, first off, you find the scene. What do you do when you find the scene?
So it's taken quite a few years. This is part of learning to see outdoors for me, is learning to choose, select. That is such a massive part of painting from life. And for years and years, color seduced me, and I would select a scene, something to paint, and I'd get done and I'd go, oh man, there's absolutely no tonal arrangement. The design is, it's non-existent. I just went after color again. And so the longer I paint, the more I become interested in shapes, dark and light shapes. And that's what I go for first when I'm outdoors. So I'm looking for composition, looking for interesting arrangement and pattern of shape. I haven't ever done thumbnails from life, which is shameful. I'm so sorry. But
well, I don't think there's a right or a wrong. Some people do, no, and some people don't.
Yeah. So here's the way I work is very, very intuitive and kind of from the gut, I guess. I'm not careful. I don't do a lot of planning or preliminary, even on my big stuff in the studio. I'm happiest when I just jump into it and just make it happen while I go, which is strange because that involves a lot of repainting, right? Because it's very, very rare that the shapes just work right from the start. But I just have to attack the canvas, just go for it, get stuff down, and then start to mold it and manipulate it. It's like I treat painting a little bit more like sculpture much more like sculpture than watercolor. If that makes sense. It's not careful and it's not planned. It's just like slap a whole bunch of clay onto the armature and mush it around until it works. So
yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So I select something that has some interesting tonal arrangements, some interesting shapes to play with, and then I just attack it.
And seeing your paintings in person, I happen to see a friend of mine is a collector of your work, and I happen to see a lot of your paintings in his house one day. And I didn't look very closely, but I didn't feel like it was big, thick buildup of paint. But Are you sculpting paint? Are you doing a lot of thick buildup?
Yes. So if it kind of depends. Sometimes in my snowscapes, there'll be a lot of thin passages and just a few kind of select thick passages. So that may have been what you saw, but, and it also, it kind of depends on like how early the paintings were too. Earlier I was using more medium. And so the paintings weren't as heavily painted. But yeah, I do use a lot of paint, and I'm able to control edges and everything a lot better that way.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's a lot of paint on them.
So, you mentioned snow painting, something a lot of us don't get a chance to do, but we, if we're doing it, we're oftentimes doing it from a photograph. Some people are willing to get out and paint outdoors. Are you getting out plein air painting in the snow?
Yeah. So my quick snow story for everybody is I've painted a lot in the snow, and it's difficult. There are really nice days and there are really horrible days.
Yeah.
You know, so I've had just kind of those amazing moments in the spring when you're just all alone and all you can hear is the snow dripping as it melts off the pines, and it's, you know, a comfortable temperature, and you can see your palette and see your surface, and it just all goes beautifully. And then I've had absolutely horrific, you know, glary days or just freezing cold days. So I had an experience up in Montana painting with a bunch of friends, where it was a bad day to be painting. It was a bad day. It was already, you know, below freezing, and then there was a nasty wind. It was just horrible. It wasn't even good looking. Do you know what I mean? The spot we were and the light was just bad. And anyway, we were all there together anyway. What's that?
One value.
It was horrible. Just horrible. But you know, we were all there painting. We just kind of all did it because we were there, and I muscled through this like 2-hour painting that was a disaster. And I didn't keep my gloves on. I took my gloves off after a bit, and I just had like my little rubber glove on my rag hand. Anyway, we went back to the restaurant to eat, and my fingers, like, they were numb, and they stayed numb, and they stayed numb, and I dipped them in hot water, and they stayed numb, and I had frost nip. I had like dead tips of my fingers for a month and a half.
Oh,
it was
no.
A nightmare. And I thought, I'm such an idiot. That was the stupidest. That was so stupid. And so that's changed my winter painting quite a bit. I'm just not so stupid anymore. I select my winter painting days carefully, and a lot of times I do paint from a photo. And if you look enough, right, if you just spend time outside looking, so my advice, I guess, for those who are interested in painting snow is, on some days, just go out and sit in the snow and keep your hands in like toasty little gloves with hand warmers and be comfortable and just paint it in your mind. And then sometimes what I'll do as well is come like right into the studio immediately after looking and paint it from the photo so that it's just fresh. And anyway, I'm just less dumb these days. So don't be dumb when you're painting outside in the cold. That's the moral of the story.
I, you know, we do this thing called Fall Color Week, and we did an event up in Banff in Lake Louise. We'll do another one someday. And of all things, you know, they had the 100-year storm, and we ended up having snow. And of course, none of us were really prepared for it, but we painted in the snow, and something right. I don't ever get to do. And I fell in love with it because the color that you think is going to be there is oftentimes a lot different than what you know. Once you see it and you study it, the color is a lot different. So have you developed any ideas or thoughts on painting snow? Do you have, there are some people who always say, you know, paint what you see. And there are others who say, no, you always want to keep your shadows cool or your shadows warm. Is there any principle that you've kind of figured out for painting snow?
I found that if you push it high key a little bit, it reads better. It feels more correct. So yeah, I've painted it a lot. And when my paintings if they're toned down, even a notch. And this is like some really subtle, like it's not three or four value steps. It's like one or a half a value step. But if you push it up just that little bit more in the shadows, and then you kind of blow out your lights a little bit, like push really, really close to white, pure white in the lights.
So what you're saying is make the shadows brighter than you see?
Well, that's probably really good advice for everybody. I see them that bright now, but that is a common tendency I find in snow paintings, is that people see a lot of contrast, just heavy contrast, right? Because it's so blindingly bright. But if you'll paint the shadows lighter, you'll feel more like it looks, you know, feel more correct.
Yeah. I would think that for me, the idea is paint small, paint fast, get out of there.
Exactly. Yeah.
These people who manage to stay out there for long periods of time, I don't know how they do it. I mean, even with good boots and good gloves and great everything, hand warmers, you know, I still am freezing.
Yeah. Yeah. And I just found that it's more value, like a small sketch with some really truthful, there's something about when you're hurried too, that creates an energy and a beauty in the painting. So I'm happier with what I do, and it informs and helps the studio work a lot more if I'm just working quick, you know, three smalls instead of one 12 by 16 that you really work out is usually a better choice.
So how does your studio work vary from your plein air work? Are you trying to capture the same level of energy? Are you doing more depth, more detail? Explain what you're doing in the studio.
Just a ton of experimentation, honestly. I love surface quality, and so I'll spend like a couple months working on just buildup of paint, like trying to lay something down, let it dry, and come over it and come over it and come over it and see what I can make happen. And then, like you said, sometimes I'll try to treat it more like I'm painting from life, really energetic and really quick and wet on wet, and just finish as I go. I'm just trying to discover, like, my nature, you know, trying to be really honest with myself and ask myself when I'm happiest when I paint. I found that if I'm in a good place, if it's drudgery for me, right? If I'm like, man, I got to make this thing work, the painting feels like that. I'm never happy with it. It never works. So I'm not a super patient painter, and I keep trying to, you know, make a painting that I just work and work and work on and make it work. And that's been difficult for me. I'm generally a lot more pleased with it if I attack it with a little more of that kind of immediacy that you get when you're outdoors, you know, that sense of urgency.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, like I'm constantly experimenting with pushing myself the other direction. I think I have kind of that. That's definitely one of my weaknesses, is I have this strange desire to be able to paint like every human that's ever put paint on canvas and then choose what I'm going to paint like. Right. So I have this, I'm constantly going, oh, I love what they're achieving with that. And then I'll work to try to be able to do that. And then I'll find that it's nothing like the way I naturally think and naturally paint and go back to the way I do things. And anyway,
the experimentation is half the fun.
Yeah, and it informs what I do later, and I learn all kinds of things. So it's good, I think, but it also can be a bit of an emotional roller coaster. As I just have a real desire to make really great things, you know. So I'm constantly pushing, and that's pushing is uncomfortable, and it can be discouraging because it leads to a lot of stinkers, a lot of failed paintings, right? Because you're trying new things and doing what you're not naturally good at. So
that's studio for me. What do you do with those stinkers?
Just battle.
You scrape them down. Do you keep working them? Do you put them away and work on them again later? What do you do?
Yeah. So chuck them. I'll throw them in the trash can and just start again. I've got, you know, stacks and stacks in the studio that occasionally I'll pull out and revisit and see if I can, you know, sometimes a year later, 2 years later, even you pull something out and you just, you have that courage again to go, oh, okay. I think let's do this. I think I can finish it. And those will turn into some of my favorite pieces a lot of times.
How big are you working in the studio?
Pretty big. I mean, 48 inches by 48 inches or 36 by 48 is kind of I like working on that scale. And so I'll do, my smalls are generally, I like the 12 by 16 ish range. And then my mediums are in the 24 range. And then I just go straight up to big, to 4 foot or 5 foot.
Oh, sounds like fun.
It's super fun. If you haven't, you know, attacked a big canvas, it is a pleasure.
Well, I never have done a 4 footer or a 5 footer. I've done, you know, 30 by 40s, but nothing bigger than that. Is there a big difference in the way that you paint them? You know, somebody told me the other day, I think it was Joe Wang. I think he said, big painting, small brushes, small painting, big brushes, which is the opposite of what you would think.
Right. That's super interesting. Yeah.
And I've been pondering that, trying to figure out what the heck he meant. And I think what he meant is that, you know, you, in the bigger paintings, you have more opportunity for detail, I suppose.
Right. There is. Yeah. And that's interesting that you say that, because I was thinking about, I did a really big, like a 48 by 72 commission this year. And I got out like a 2-inch or three or, no, it's bigger than that. It's like a 4-inch chip brush, kind of like a house painting brush, but bristles. And I mixed huge puddles of paint and I, you know, treated it like it was 24 by 30 or whatever. And it was fun to do. Really fun to do, but it didn't read correctly. Like you don't step far enough away from a huge painting like that for a 4-inch brush to read correctly. So I think I see what he's saying, where I had to come in with smaller brushes and really refine a lot of those big broad marks that I'd made, because you're up close to it, and so it just, it looks a mess unless you get into it a little more.
Well, that'll be a good challenge for all of us to try that. I think we should all go out and buy a 5-foot canvas, stretched canvas, and try it and see what happens.
Yeah.
We'll report back
to you. It is fun. Yeah, okay. Deal.
Now, how much teaching are you doing?
I do one workshop from my studio here in Paradise a year. I do it in the spring. And then I'll usually say yes to like one or two other engagements. And I do have a problem saying no, actually. So especially, I mean, like someone calls and says, hey, would you like to teach plein air in France or Spain or whatever? I'm like, yes. Yes, I would. That would be fantastic.
Yes, I would. Yes, all expenses paid, please.
Yeah, that's right. So it turns into about three workshops here.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, that's actually quite a few when you think about it, because of the commitment that it requires.
Yeah.
And what are you finding that the common threads that you're seeing in workshops that you're trying to help people overcome?
Fear.
Fear.
I think that is the thing. Yeah. People are, they're worried. They're timid in their painting, and that ruins everything. And I've got she's 4 years old now, my little girl, Emily. that has taught me so much about painting. I have her out there and I squirt out a whole bunch of oil paint for her and I just watch her, and it's just the most joyous thing. I've actually been doing a bunch of abstracts the past couple of weeks and like trying to channel a little bit of that just just have fun. That inner me that just loves making something, you know, because we all had it when we were little. But people come to workshops and they have almost entirely quenched that part of them that's fearless and that loves to just make marks. And they're worried about, you know, what's everyone else in the workshop going to think of this painting? And anyway, and so their paintings are, they just reek of uncertainty, right? You can smell it. It gets stuck in the paint and they're timid and they're nervous and the strokes look that way. And anyway, so I try to help them. Well, we go small. We go really small in the workshop and big brush, right? Joe Wang, big brush, little canvas. And I go, don't worry if the drawing's off. Don't worry if you don't like the composition. Like we're not out here to make masterpieces. We're out here to learn and try to get them back to a place where they're just more fearless, more confident, and more joyful outside. And that changes everything.
Well, that's a great observation. You know, we all fall in love with our work. You know, especially if we do something that we really like, that, you know, we're like, wow, I really nailed that tree. And then, you know, you right. spend all your time preserving that tree and working around it, you know, it doesn't work, but it's very easy. I think that's an important lesson, overcoming the fear. Thank you for that.
Yeah. Yep. I think it's super key.
So what's the big goal for you? Have you ever had something, you know, that you've been thinking about that it's like, I gotta do this. This is, you know, something that's really important for me to do in my lifetime or my career, whether it has to do with painting or something else.
Yeah. So my artistic dreams are big. They're lofty. Like I have always been in love with, the Russian itinerant movement, with Levitin, Shishkin, and Polnov, and Kramskoy, and Repin. Anyway, there's tons of them. There's just they're bonkers. They're fantastic masters, and they made these paintings. I think a 48x72 is big. Like try 9 foot by 12 foot, right?
Oh,
with
yeah.
500 figures or whatever. You know,
or 30 feet, yeah. It's amazing.
so fearless, and so, man, their paintings make me so happy. So I've always wanted that. I've wanted more in my paintings. Landscape for me has been a way to learn how to paint. I love the landscape, but I can't spend my whole life just painting the landscape. So this is kind of a critical point in my career, I feel like, where I'm trying to find how Josh paints the figure in the landscape. And I have, you know, big stories. I come from a pioneer stock, right? The people that traveled out west and settled this area are my ancestors. And so telling their story is something that I'm really passionate about, what I'm excited about. And yeah, that involves much more complex paintings with figures and animals and just a lot going on. So I feel like it's been like 13 years, unbelievably, since I graduated college. It just blows my mind. But this 13 years has been so good as I've pushed and grown and tried to learn how to see and how to paint. And I've got a lot more of that growing to do, but I could spend my whole life just trying to get better. And that is not going to be sufficient. That's not going to suit you. I have to start to become that Russian that's way deep down inside me and push myself on these bigger, more complex.
Well, you're going to have to. Have you been to Russia?
I have. It was just a dreamy couple of weeks. The Tretyakov and the Russian State Museum.
Two best museums in the world. And in terms of seeing those kinds of things, I'm taking a group of 50 artists in September of 21 for 2 weeks in the fall. We're going to paint in St. Petersburg. We're going to paint in the small villages, and we're going to paint in Moscow. And we also have, we're doing a private tour. We have a private entry into the Hermitage, but we also have, we're going to be going to the Russian State Museum. We're going to be going to the Tretikov Museum, and we're going to be meeting with and hanging out with Russian painters, some who are going to hang with us the whole time. And these people know how to do it. And that's part of their training. You know, when they graduate, they have to have a graduate project where they have to do giant multi-figure paintings.
Yeah, yeah.
And so some of the great paintings that you see that were done by some of these people that you've mentioned, a lot of them were their graduate projects. Of course, when they graduate, I mean, they're at a level so much higher than anything we've ever done.
It's amazing. Yeah, Reppin's or Fessian's graduate piece. Oh, my heavens.
Fessian's, the potato. That's unbelievable.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah. Yeah, they inspire me. And I think that movement, more than any other, those men and women that painted those masterpieces, like that's what I want to be when I grow up. I want to be that fearless and that, just that confident and joyful in my work. It's beautiful.
Well, I think that's a terrific thing to strive for, and I think it makes a lot of sense. Certainly would be fun to see what you come up with. So I think we're all going to challenge you now, is you need to go out and buy a 10-foot stretched canvas. We'll start small with 10 feet, and you don't have to put in more than 20 figures.
No, that is a good challenge. I like it. I'll do that. I'll just,
yeah. And
make
you can,
it happen.
You know, you can do the, stagecoaches crossing the pass and seeing the Utah Valley or the Salt Lake Valley for the first time. And you can have Brigham Young saying, this is the place. Isn't that what he said? I think.
yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
There's actually, yeah. So my next show, there's a bunch of pioneers who went down and settled, like the Moab area of the state, and their story of taking wagons through those canyons is unbelievable. And yeah, so such an inspiring story, and the paintings that are possible from this thing of like, it's one of the most beautiful places on the planet. So yeah, I'll do that, man. 10-foot canvas. Here goes.
All right, good. Well, we'll all be looking for you to finish it.
Okay.
We won't put any time limit on you though.
Good. Yeah. Those guys worked a long time on those. So I'll do the same.
So in terms of best advice, the two questions I get the most from our listeners are, what's the best possible way to train yourself to learn plein air painting? I think you've answered that. And then the second one is, what's the best possible way to bring yourself to the higher level? Because we all tend to get to a point where we get stuck and we don't feel like we're growing at a higher level. How do you get there?
Right. I think, as I'm looking back on my own progression and the times when I progressed the most, I think a key for me was repetition. So maybe painting, for me it was head painting, right? And it was a very similar lighting condition, and it was 3 times a week, 3 hours of sitting, and 3 years, you know, of just like 3 heads a week, same light, same situation, just boom, 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 boom. And I think that really, really rapidly increased my growth, because it was the same problem over and over again, and I wasn't solving it, but it took that kind of time attacking the same problem to really start to solve it. And so I think maybe with a plein air painter who's going to Banff and then painting snow and then heading to the coast, and then, you know, that's kind of what we tend to do. We roam and we love to see new things and tackle it. But if you really want to grow, paint your backyard every day for the next 3 years, every single day. And I think for me anyway, that was critical to really rapid growth.
Well, that's great advice. And because you're going to see it differently every single day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you'll really come to understand it and see much, much deeper than you do if you're just... We have kind of an Instagram-ish mentality, right? We're so quickly on to the next thing, so easily bored. So by that repetition of just paint this, it's going to be different every day. Super, super subtle, beautiful differences that you won't see unless you look at it every day. So, yeah, that's my advice.
Great advice. Well, Josh Clare, this has been fabulous having you on the Plein Air Podcast. Thank you so much for being on today.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure. Thanks, Eric.
Well, thank you again to Josh Clare. Now, what a really nice man and what a great painter. And I'm really excited. I think he'll accept the challenge. We'll do get him to do a really big painting. I think we should all try it. I think it'd be fun. All right. You guys ready for some marketing ideas?
This is the Marketing Minute with Eric Rhoads, author of the number one Amazon bestseller, Make More Money Selling Your Art, Proven Techniques to Turn Your Passion into Profit.
In the Marketing Minute, I answer your art marketing questions. You can email yours to eric@artmarketing.com. I never see the questions before I read them now as I'm reading them to you. So I'm making it up off the top of my head. So sometimes I stumble a bit, but I try to give you marketing advice from my decades of experience. This one comes from Zayn Moore in Richmond, Virginia, who asked, what are some of the non-conventional venues where artists can show our work? How can we zig when everyone else is zagging? Well, that's a principle that I teach is, you know, when everybody else is doing one thing, do you want to do what everybody else is doing? Why not do something different? Well, you can think in terms of non-conventional things. Well, first off, I would ask myself this question. Who buys paintings? Who's most likely to buy paintings? And where do those people hang out? Right. And so I was thinking about this one the other day, as a matter of fact, car dealers. You know, if let's say you sell really, really expensive paintings, why not do a show at the Bentley dealer or at the Lexus dealer or the Mercedes dealer? You know, so you're bringing it down a notch. But the idea is that you are focusing on going to places where people hang out. You know, like if I have my car and I have to go into the dealer and I have to sit in the waiting room for an hour waiting for them to change the oil or the tires or something, why not do a show in a place like that? Where else could you go? Now, I would say a laundromat, not probably a great idea because first off, it's not necessarily going to be people who are going to have the money. Typically, people using laundromats don't have the money to buy paintings. Maybe they do, some don't. But, you know, where are people spending time? They're spending time in doctor's offices, you know, especially like plastic surgeons, that people who get plastic surgery tend to be people who have a little bit more money. So think in terms of where do wealthy people hang out? You know, country clubs, golf clubs. There are lots of different places like that. Of course, it's all changed with COVID. Certainly fancy restaurants, but look for places where my famous saying is stand in the river where the money is flowing, and you can do that and be unconventional, not just do what everyone else is doing. All right. Here's a question from Kelly Watson in Cleveland, Ohio. I was just in Cleveland recently. Kelly, she says, I worry about what collectors would think about my process. Specifically, is it considered cheating? Or is it okay to use Photoshop when coming up with color combinations or composition concepts? Well, I suppose, Kelly, it depends on who you ask. And if you ask me, it's not a problem. Now, you know, there are people who will say, well, it's not right to use a projector because you're projecting the image onto a big canvas to blow it up or something. I'm not so much a purist. I think what matters is that you get a great painting and that, you know, when photographs were first revealed, some of the great painters were using photographs, even people like Bouguereau, who was head of the Beaux-Arts school in France. He was using photographs because, you know, models are expensive. You can use photographs. A lot of people use photographs to move objects around. And you know, the whole idea is to create a beautiful painting. And so if you're using Photoshop or you're using some iPad program or some other thing to kind of figure out your composition and your colors and your color harmony, why not? Is, you know, ultimately you're going to do the painting and the painting is going to be what people see, and how you do it really doesn't matter. What you do matters, and that's doing something really fine. So I hope this helps, and I hope these give you some ideas for marketing.
This has been the Marketing Minute with Eric Rhoads. You can learn more at artmarketing.com.
Well, thanks again for listening today. I want to remind you guys that we have the Plein Air Convention coming up. Just go to PleinAirConvention.com. We also, this next week, Realism Live. You don't want to miss that. It's going to be phenomenal. There's 100% money-back guarantee. If you watch the first day and you don't feel like you got all your money's worth in the first day. And remember, there's 5 days, including the beginner's day. But if you watch the first day and you don't dig it, let us know. We'll give you your money back. You don't have to watch the rest of the thing. You won't be able to because we're going to cut the cord on you. But please know that it's going to be that good. Just at least go to Realism Live and look and see who the faculty members are. While you're looking, while you're cruising around, go to Watercolor Live, too, and check that out. That's coming up in January. Anyway, I hope you guys have a really terrific day. If you've not seen my blog where I talk about art and light, life and other things, it's called Sunday Coffee, and you can find it at coffeewitheric.com. Always fun doing this. We'll do it again sometime, like hopefully next week. God willing, we will see you then. My name is Eric Rhoads. I'm the publisher and founder of Plein Air Magazine, and you can find us online at outdoorpainter.com. Remember, it's a big world out there. Go paint it. We'll see you. Bye-bye.
This has been the Plein Air Podcast with Plein Air Magazine's Eric Rhoads. You can help spread the word about Plein Air painting by sharing this podcast with your friends. And you can leave a review or subscribe on iTunes so it comes to you every week. And you can even reach Eric by email, eric@pleinairmagazine.com. Be sure to pick up our free ebook, 240 Plein Air Painting Tips by some of America's top painters. It's free at pleinairtips.com. Tune in next week for more great interviews. Thanks for listening.